Hello, and welcome back to my course on learning commands in Minecraft. My name is slicedlime, and today we're going to learn how to use the basic commands from last time with relative coordinates and start our journey to understanding how to use commands with entities. We left off last time having learned how to make command block chains and use the setBlock command to set a gold and an emerald block every tick. This far, we've entered exactly where we want those blocks to end up though, which means that our commands only work in one specific location. That means that if you wanted to share this fancy gold setBlock command with a friend, they'd need to be at exactly the same place in their world for it to work. The solution to this problem is called relative coordinates. The coordinates we've been using this far are called absolute coordinates. To mark that we want a coordinate to be interpreted as relative, we started using a tilde sign. Take a moment to locate how to type this. It is something I cannot easily teach you because it tends to be very different on different keyboard layouts. You might even have to hit space after pressing the correct button or button combination to make the character appear. When a coordinate is relative, that means that it references an offset to some other position. You could think of the tilde as meaning here. So when the absolute coordinate 10 on the x-axis means a specific place in the world, the relative coordinate tilde 10 on the x-axis means 10 blocks east of here. If we instead wanted to go west, we could simply use a negative relative coordinate instead, which would be written like tilde minus 10. As a special case, tilde 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 means right here. The crux here is what the frame of reference is. Where is here when running a command? The answer depends on how you run the command. When typing any command through chat, the position of your player in the world is the frame of reference. That means tilde 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 means exactly the coordinates you'll see on the F3 screen, which, as it turns out, represent the very center of the bottom of your character's feet. As an example, if you were to run a setBlock command on the position tilde tilde tilde, the block would appear so that the lower half of your body was now inside of it. When running a command through a command block, the frame of reference is the position of that block. That means you can take the same command and run it in several different command blocks, and that will point out several different blocks, as long as the coordinates were specified as relative coordinates. To take the same example again, running a setBlock command on the position tilde 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 in a command block will replace that command block with the new block, deleting the command block in the process. A self-destructing command block. In other cases that we haven't really talked about yet, like running a command through the server console or a tag function, the frame of reference is the world spawn. Don't worry if you don't know what these things are yet, we'll learn more about them later. If you need a way to remember which direction is which, there's a helper in the game. When the F3 screen is active, there's a small coordinate system marker with red, green, and blue lines anchored in the center of the screen, where your crosshair is. Red, green, and blue here correspond to X, Y, and Z, so you can always get a quick visual indication for which way positive X and Z are. And positive Y is always up, so green will always be pointing up. Another thing to keep in mind is that the relativeness of the coordinates is specified one coordinate at a time. That means it's possible to mix absolute and relative coordinates to, for instance, say things like here where I am right now, but at height 70 in the world. Let's put these relative coordinates to the test with a new command, the summon command. As usual, we can find more information about how to use it by typing /help summon, or get syntax help and suggestions by typing /summon. As you can see, the game first expects an entity type. Then, you can specify a position, but it's not mandatory. Remember that the square brackets mean an optional argument. If you don't specify a position, the command acts as if you had used the right here form, tilde tilde tilde. This goes for anywhere in the game where a command has an optional position input. So, let's try it out. Let's summon a chicken falling from the sky above me, /summon chicken. Remember here that the Minecraft colon that the game suggests is optional, as we discussed in the previous episode. And now the position. We want it to be falling from above me, so let's set the X and Z coordinates to right here. Tilde, tilde, tilde. For our Y coordinates, we'll simply raise it up into the sky above me, let's say by 20 blocks. So I'll change the Y to be tilde 20. And that's our full coordinates, tilde, tilde 20, tilde. Here, but 20 blocks up. And here's our chicken floating majestically out of the sky. We can do this for almost any entity type in the game. Again, we can use the suggestions to list the types and find the one we want. Of course, a pig falls less majestically than a chicken, but we could also summon entities that aren't mobs, like an arrow. Take a moment to explore the different entities you can summon. If you're unsure what an entity type is called, one way to find out is to look that entity up on the Minecraft Wiki. Look for the data value section to find out the ID. It's the value under the resource location column. Before we move on to our last topic for this time, let me ask you to take a quick moment to summon a click on the like button for the video. It lets YouTube know that you found this video helpful and that so might others, so it helps it spread. Thank you. I really appreciate that. Let's spend the last little while of today's episode diving deeper into command blocks. We've learned about the activation settings before, and last time we learned about the mode, impulse, repeat, or chain. Let's look at the last toggle in the command block interface, the conditional toggle. A conditional command block only runs the command it has if the block placed before it, according to the direction of the block, is a command block that successfully executed its command. To demonstrate, let's set up a command block chain again. We'll create an impulse command block and make sure it points sideways. We'll set its command to setBlock tilde tilde 1 tilde gold block. That is, change the block directly above the command block to be a gold block. To test that it works, let's once again put a button on the command block. Okay, so we got our gold block. We can also open the command block to look at the previous output row. This shows what happened when the command ran, which in this case tells us the block was changed. Let's click the button again. Of course, we saw no difference because the gold block was already there. If we look in the command block again and check the output, we'll see that there's now an error there. Could not set the block. So, the result of the command was different, depending on the state of the world. Now, let's create a second block in the chain. Let's put a chain command block after it, and make sure the direction is the same as our first block. The arrows on the side should line up. In this one, we'll use the summon command we just learned, summon bat, tilde, tilde 1, tilde. So, summon a bat right on top of the command block. Remember that chain blocks need to be set to always active to work. Let's click the button again to test it. Of course, the gold block didn't change, but the bat spawned. If we click it again, we get another bat. Now, let's look at the interface for that chain command block. We're going to toggle the unconditional button here to conditional. Notice how the arrow on the block changed when I hit done. It's now got an indent from the side, showing that this is a conditional block. Let's hit the button again. Notice how nothing happened. We didn't get a new bat this time. And that is because since the gold block is already there, the first command failed. Punch out the gold block, trigger the chain again, and now we get both the gold block and the bat. The command in the conditional chain block was run this time, since the setBlock command in the first command block successfully placed the block. Keep in mind that a conditional command block doesn't affect the rest of the chain. If we place more command blocks after this one, they will execute individually regardless of the condition. And if we make the next one conditional, it in turn will look at the bat summoning command to know whether it should run or not, regardless of if the bat summoning was even attempted this run through the chain. It can sometimes be fairly hard to track logic this way, as conditions change when command blocks change run. For a more complex system, we'll have much better ways of dealing with the results of commands later on, so if it seems very complicated to do things this way, don't worry. Your toolbox will keep expanding with more tools in future episodes. That's it for today, though. We learned the basics of relative coordinates, summoned our first entities, and made commands that only trigger when other commands succeeded. As always, make sure you get the companion map and play through the exercises there.